Hey guys, welcome to the Scholar Online YouTube channel, the channel that is all about learning. In this channel, I make a lot of videos on how to create your own website, how to create your own e-commerce or WooCommerce website and start making money online by selling products online. If you're new to this channel, please remember to hit the subscribe button. You can find it at the bottom of the video and just hit subscribe. Please like this video if you like my content and remember to leave me a comment below. Talk to me, let me know what you like about the videos, what you don't like about the videos, what I can do to improve on these videos. And if you're new to the channel as well, if you go to the description, there is video timestamps available for you. If you want to jump ahead to certain sections of the video, if you don't want to watch the entire video, please feel free to utilize those video timestamps and follow us on our social media channels. We've got a Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram page, and let's start learning. In this video, we're going to do something different. I think a lot of people think that we are an e-commerce learning school or we're an e-commerce based YouTube channel, but actually we are a learning platform for everything digital. And we are going to start learning about what we call VPS machines or virtual private servers. So, and I'm going to take you through the process of creating one on Digital Ocean and setting it up so that it's ready to run your programs on the cloud. So before we do that, let's just go through, first of all, we are talking about a VPS, which is short for a virtual private server or a virtual machine. Okay, so why would you want to use a VPS or a virtual private server? The first reason why I personally like to choose them is that they are usually faster than shared servers. So if you're trying to host a website, for example, you could either go for shared, a shared computing or a shared server where you're hosting your machine with other people sharing the same IP address, but that is usually a bit slower. And, you can't configure much. You basically can only do, what's available to you based on the operating system that the shared server is working with. But if you create your own private server, you could set it up the way that you want from the operating system upwards. The second thing is that you have more customization. You can pretty much put whatever operating system you like, file structure, which enables you to do a whole lot of complex tasks you would not be able to do with shared hosting. You can host more things, okay? You can host a web application. You can host a database. You can host even an e-commerce website. You can even host a WordPress website. You can host even multiple sites. You can host for one VPS machine up to 100 websites, depending on the size of the VPS, okay? So you can do multiple things with it that you wouldn't be able to do with shared hosting. And the last one is you can run continuous programs. And so the second part of this tutorial will be when I'm showing you how to run a Python program on a VPS that's going to be running continuously day and night, whether you're awake, whether you're sleeping, running on the VPS. And you can only do this on a VPS. So that's one of the things I love about this machine. So let's get started. So get over to your Internet Explorer and let's search for... let's do a quick comparison first. So let's start on DigitalOcean. So just go to www.digitalocean.com. All right. And then under products, under products, let's click on droplets. Okay. So they call their virtual machines or the VPS virtual private servers are droplets, but it's basically the same thing. They have a lot of other services that they offer here, guys, and you won't have time to go through all of it today, but let's just focus on the droplets. And so go through this and read it, right? So this is what they offer in terms of droplets, and you can see the operating systems that they offer. You can install anything from Ubuntu to Debian to Fedora. It's really up to you depending on what you're going to be using this droplet for. All right, and you can see their performance based on the industry standards. There's a lot if you want to sort of go through what they're offering that you can read through here on DigitalOcean. But I want to just show you quickly the pricing and why a VPS actually offers you better value for money if you're not willing to get your hands, if you're not afraid to get your hands dirty. So the cheapest VPS that they've got is this 1 gig. One CPU, 1 terabyte transfer, that's 25 gigs of space, and you're only going to be paying $5 for this a month. I did a quick calculation. $5 is approximately currently with the exchange rate in South Africa about 80 rand. All right, so I'm going to compare this with the best, I believe, South African hosting provider, which is domains.co.zn, and they've got a similar package. Okay, one CPU core, one memory. Actually, this 500 gig of traffic, and this one here is 1 terabyte of traffic. So actually, they've got a better deal on Digital Ocean than on domains.co.zn. But then this is 139. It's also a little bit more expensive, because on Digital Ocean you're paying just $5, which is about 86 rand, 80 rand. So the Digital Ocean deal is better, but the reason why I would still use domains.co.zn, even if it was more expensive, is that Digital Ocean is based way. I mean, if you look at their, let's just go back here and look at their server location. Their servers are based in the US. They're based, let's scroll down here. They're based on, you can't see it here. You'll see it when you're selecting your VPS machine. They're based in the US, they're based in Europe. They're far, far away. So it actually offsets one of the reasons why you want to use a VPS machine. It will not be extremely fast because of the location. But the South African VPS, and I've used it, is extremely fast. So if you want to optimize speed and you want to build a website and you focus on SEO and you want your speed to be as fast as possible, actually you're better off hosting off a VPS than a normal shared hosting. And then you want a local VPS. You don't want to work with DigitalOcean or any other cloud-based platforms that are not based in South Africa. They will not be faster than the South African-based ones in Johannesburg. Then, so I've shown you the comparison. It's up to you which one you want to go for, but the setup process is going to be similar, whichever one you choose. So let's do the setup for Digital Ocean Droplet. And the reason why I'm going to go for Digital Ocean is that they have amazing tutorials online showing you how to do a lot of these things that I'm going to be taking you through. I'm actually going to be going through a Digital Ocean tutorial myself as I'm showing you this, because once you're done with this video, you can take the link that I'm going to give to you, and in your own time, because the tutorials are very well written and they're constantly revised to make sure that they're up to date, you can actually go through that written tutorial yourself in your own private time and go through the points and make sure you don't miss anything, and then you will be able to do exactly what I did here today. So the first tutorial that we're going to go through is this one here that says initial server setup with Ubuntu 20.4. Okay, and if you look at the tutorial that I will link here below, as you start to read it, if you're not using Ubuntu 20.4, you can choose whatever operating system that you have actually installed in your droplet, and on the drop-down menu. So if you're using Ubuntu 16 or 18 or Debian 10, whatever, you could select it down here. And if you click and say you're using Debian 10, the tutorial will change and take you to the tutorial for Debian 10 setup. You understand? So this Digital Ocean is really well written, but we're going to install Ubuntu 20.4. Right? So we're going to go back to that, and it's going to take us back to the Ubuntu 20.04 tutorial. And so let's just go through the process of purchasing a Digital Ocean droplet. So I'm going to say create an account. All right, when we reach this stage, we will need to go to our email and confirm. So let me just do that quickly. So once you have confirmed your email address, just go back and log into your account and go under droplets. And you will see there that you currently don't have any droplet. So we're going to start creating a new droplet from scratch. So just click on create a droplet. Okay. We are going to work with Ubuntu. Okay. But you could pick any operating system that you like over there. And on the drop-down menu, you can pick the version of the operating system. So for example, we're going to pick Ubuntu. But you could pick Ubuntu and a different version, whatever version you like, from 16 all the way to 20 times 64. So we're going to leave it at this one, okay? And we're going to go with the basic plan, and we're going to go with the one that is a $5 plan, and just click on that, all right? So basically, this $5 plan is the cheapest one, and that's what we're going to go for, right? Then these are all the different data centers that you can work with. And this is what I was talking about when I was saying that it's very important where your droplet is located when it comes to speed, all right? The South African VPS hosting services might be a little bit more expensive if you look at domains, but it's going to be much faster because the data servers are located right here in Johannesburg. If you're going to work with a data server that is overseas, you're going to it's going to be a little bit slower, but not too slow. It also depends on what you're trying to achieve with your droplet. So in my case, I just want to build a droplet, and we're going to run some Python programs on it, things like updating Twitter posts, sending myself emails automatically, automating some tasks, which we're going to go through in this Scholar online course. I'm definitely going to, it doesn't matter where the data center is located, speed is not important, but I do not like to work with data centers off of the US because of the legislation there. If you base your data center in the US, it means you are governed by the rules of that country. So your data is governed by the rules of that country, and they can cease and desist your data, your information, and you need to be aware of the rules of the country of where you are hosting your information. And I don't have time to figure out what are the rules, and because I'm not doing anything majorly big, but I still don't like to host in the US. I'm going to either go for Singapore or London, but actually I think London is better, so closer to me, and I also like the fact that we are almost in a similar time zone with London. Then so once you've done that, you're gonna see the VPC network, the default, that's fine. Select additional options. No, we're not gonna do that. So you have two. When you get here, you have two options, and this is very, very important, and please take note of this. You can either go for SSH keys, or you can create a password, all right? A password is definitely less secure, and I do not recommend that you do it. Please do not go for the password option, because a password option is easy to crack. All somebody needs to do is to learn your password, and just like that, they have access to your VPS machine, all right? But you can also select SSH keys and then work with an SSH key. So let's look at the SSH keys. So if you select SSH keys, you would have to submit a new SSH key, and then you need to put in the key content there. SSH keys has two parts. They have a public key and a private key, all right? So what you can do is that you can follow this instruction to create add SSH keys on Linux, all right? Create a new key pair if needed, open the terminal and run the following command, okay? So you can go to your terminal and run this command, and then you're gonna get a SSH key that you can then copy and paste somewhere else and do it that way. But I don't want to do this because I already have an SSH key on my terminal, and I don't want to create one here because then it's going to maybe clash with my other SSH key. So I'm going to actually go back to the password option. But keep in mind, you actually want the SSH option. So let's go for the password option. All right. Once you've done that, you can choose the name of what, or your machine, what you want to call it. All right. So I want to call it Scholar Learning. Right. And I don't want to do backups. I don't mind about that. And then we're going to create the droplet. Right, so it's working to create our droplet, working. All right. Once it's finished working, take note of your IP, right? So you can just copy that, right? And you can go to your terminal, any terminal window, and you can just type in SSH, right? Root at that, all right? Your IP, and press enter, all right? So it's going to ask you, do you trust this machine? You wanna connect to them? Yes, I do, all right? And then you have to enter the password. This is your root password that you created. So every time you log into your machine, you are entering the password. There you go, right? And you can see that you are root at Scholar Learning, okay? So we are now inside the VPS machine, and we can run commands, we can do anything we want. In
inside the VPS machine. But I actually want to follow this tutorial that we have here, initial server setup with Ubuntu. And we have also the tutorial for setting up SSH keys. I'm going to also keep this for you and link it on the description below. And you can follow this and please do set up the SSH keys before you do anything else, especially if you're going to do anything important. But for what we're doing, we can work off the passwords, okay? So let's try this tutorial. All right, so I've already logged in, root at my IP, and then I want to add a user, okay? Add user called Scholar. The user password. We tap the password. All right. My full name is Bertha. Room number, phone. It's correct. Yes. All right. So that's done. We set up a new user. And then what we're going to do after setting up the new user, we're going to modify the user privileges of our new user. Okay. So let's just do that. Oh, awesome. So user Scholar should now have sudo privileges. Okay. And let's test this quickly. So let's exit. Exit and try logging in as SSH Scholar at our IP address. So this is our IP address. So just copy it and paste it there again. All right. And let's enter in our password is there you go. Okay. I am now logged in as scholar.scholarlearning, and everything I'm going to do now going forward, I can do it off my whatever. So you can log in as Scholar or you can log in as admin. Now I'm going to end this tutorial here, and I'm going to give you the links, and you can follow these links in your own time, because the next thing you want to do is to set up the firewall. But be very careful. I actually do testing this. I made a mistake and setting up the firewall. I had not set up my SSH keys, and then I had already blocked the SSH login, and therefore I could not log in any other way except for the SSH. So when you follow this tutorial, follow it exactly, and make sure that before you set up the firewall, you have set up the SSH keys. So this is the next thing that you want to do, because it's a different setup for Windows and for Mac. I'd like you to just follow the tutorial and figure it out yourself. Once you've done this, then you can set up the firewall, because if you set up the firewall before you do this, you're going to have some problem, okay? So thank you guys for watching, and we're going to do a lot of exciting stuff for this VPS machine of ours. See you next time.